Louis. I'm a digital watch collector. Been collecting digital watches for about 5 years, a concentrated 5 years. Probably first started, the very first digital watch that triggered me off was actually probably when I was about 21, and there was a Fossil made a reissue of a watch that was an LED watch at the time, so going back to kind of the watches of the early 70s, and that was, I found that really, really fascinating. That was my only watch at the time, and then maybe about 5 years ago I was on eBay, and then I kind of came across, just by chance, there was a digital computer watch that I happen to remember from when I was about 8 years old. I remember seeing it in kind of a shop window in Manchester, and thinking it was the most amazing thing that I'd ever seen, and at the time I remember it was about £200, so I just had this vivid memory of that, and so I guess it was nostalgia that led me to kind of track that down, and eBay was brilliant for that, and then since then I've been then trying to basically tracking down other memory for the watches as I could remember, and that led me just getting really into the world of digital watches and exploring all the different types and makes and functions and features, and so my collection's kind of just grown in that time, really. And I've got about 350 sort of digital watches. The main period's probably from about 1977 till about 1984, which seemed to be kind of the heyday of the digital watch, but they go as far back as 1972, and I've kind of got some of the world's first LCD digital watches, up to kind of the sort of the late 80s and the early 90s seem to be kind of the end of the glory years of the digital watch, as they've probably exhausted every possibility they could do, computer watches, gadgety, gimmicky watches. So that's my collection behind me, which I'll show you some specific highlights of. This is the one that started it all off, so it's the Seiko Data 2000. And this was from about 1983, and this is one that I remember, and the big feature was that it had kind of the attachable keyboard, and so basically the watch was really kind of a memo and calendar watch, which you could kind of attach to the keyboard and type in your notes, and that was the one. It was really touted as kind of the world's first computer watch. Hot on the heels of that one, a year later, Seiko created kind of a follow-up, which was very similar, colour scheme slightly different, but features another peripheral, which is an attachable printer, but also kind of featured this ROM expansion pack, so you could buy different cartridges that could have games that you could download onto the watch as well as printing out your memos and calendar notes and things, which was kind of on like a traditional till receipt there. So that one I always think is that really interesting. This one's famous. In fact, there's a lot of them. I'll talk you through those that are famous for TV and film connections. This one was used by the cast of Battlestar Galactica. So the big chief had this one, and his lower sort of sergeants and soldiers, they had a silver version. World's first voice recording watch. This was worn by the Ghostbusters in 1984, so that's a beautiful, real chunky design, could record 8 seconds of voice, so that was pretty useless at the time, but still, everyone was really keen. Lots of technological firsts, which I was fascinated with watches. So we look at modern technology, and in fact I gave a recent talk about this because it's something I find really fascinating. Look at loads of kind of modern mobile things that we're used to, so touch screen and sort of gesture recognition and handwriting recognition. Lots of these things have been around in watches since the sort of very early 80s. Also famous from Octopussy, worn by Roger Moore, and that's the TV watch. What they never showed in any of the advertising on the film is, for the watch to work, it had a connector to kind of a massive receiver pack that you'd have to stick in your pocket. It was the size of an 80s Walkman, but that was interesting. This is an Omega Sports Quartz watch, and actually you browse through its functions by kind of swiping on a touch sensitive panel, so some of the world's first kind of touch control there.
And that's the kind of a radio sort of watch and, that it had as well, which kind of has a quite nice, this is quite a rare watch, has a little aerial that expands out, which looks quite groovy. So next one, it's called the Omega Montreal, and it's modelled on the 1975 Montreal Olympic scoreboard, so it's got a digital and analogue split. That became quite a popular theme of dual analogue and digital, and again Seiko had lots of those. And there's a few others, I suppose, in sporting. There's this is a watch for the Ford Motor Company, but it was made by Her, which was kind of Tag Her before they merged, as people would know it. So that's quite a collectible one there. Yeah. And there's kind of various others. You know, there's things like the different diving watches, which are quite light. And other different kind of ones that have different communications, so like those what they call, not faxes, the different types of things like that. But the divers ones are really quite interesting. They have kind of loads of different functions and quite nice. And then just various sort of sports and different ranges. And these two are interesting. These Seikos from the early 90s. They're basically a DJ's drum machine watch. So if you're a DJ and you would literally hold the watch up to your ear and it tap out a beat, so you could try and follow. I don't know how useful it was, but the watches look really cool, and they came in about three or four different sort of garish shades. So that's kind of summary, really. I've started to slow down now in my watch collecting. Of all the ones that I was really keen to track down, I pretty much have everything. I think one of the more recent ones was the touch input calculator watch that I had, but I still have. I get most of them from eBay, and I've been doing it through kind of saved searches of specific watches that I've been after, and so I keep these saved searches running. You know, I've basically been maxing out eBay's saved search capacity for years, but I've kind of trimmed that back down now, so I've maybe only got a dozen or so kind of watches that I'm still looking to track down. So I do keep a lookout, but yeah, I'm kind of happy that I've got my collection to kind of all the key pieces that I've been interested in.